Hi everyone, my name is Steve Lillyston and you're tuned in to Our Library, which is a 60-minute programme sponsored by the lovely folk at the libraries from around Wairarapa. To let you know about some of the many new books being introduced, so you can get in quick and place a reservation on them. And I'll also be talking about some of the services that are on offer in all the libraries across Wairarapa. Our programme, Our Library, is being broadcast to you today on Arrow 92.7 FM, your community access radio channel, and Wairarapa TV on Freeview Channel 41. This programme is broadcast live on the third Friday of each month at 3:30 PM and repeated on the fourth Friday again at 3:30 PM. So let's get started. So I go through the just some of the fiction that's being introduced into the library in your area. First of all, then I'll go on and talk about the non-fiction, and then we'll talk about some of the programmes available in all the libraries in Wairarapa. So on the fiction side, first up is All to Blazes. This is by Frank Sargeson, well-known Kiwi writer. All to Blazes is a selection of the finest stories of Frank Sargeson from 1903 to 1982. Sargeson's stories capture the everyday life of ordinary New Zealanders at home, at work, and in search of both. Originally published between 1935 and 1966, they're still fresh, still fizzing with linguistic energy, and still able to shock as well as delight. Now, Frank Sargeson was born in Hamilton in New Zealand on the 23rd of March 1903, second of four children. His name at birth was Norris Frank Davy, but he would later adopt the surname of his mother, Rachel Sargeson, for whatever reason I'm not aware. Although later in life, Sargeson became known for his literary depiction of the laconic and unsophisticated New Zealand working class men. His upbringing was comfortable and middle class. Sargeson continued to nurture and promote New Zealand literary talent, as he had with Speaking for Ourselves, most notably by inviting the young author and poet Janet Frame to live in the former army hut on his property in 1955, not long after her discharge from Seacliff Lunatic Asylum. She lived and worked in the army hut from April 55 to July 56, producing her first full-length novel, Owls Do Cry, which is considered a masterpiece of New Zealand writing. So that's Frank Sargeson. Lovely writer, and still fresh and still just so joyful to read. Frank Sargeson, lovely short stories. All to Blazes by Frank Sargeson. Next is A Family Secret. This is by Libby Ashworth. Set in Lancashire in 1842, 16-year-old Bessie works long hours as a weaver in Blackburn, helping to support her family. Meanwhile, her older sister Peggy works as an apprentice at the girls' school, hoping for a more prosperous future as a schoolteacher. Janet and Titus Eastwood have always made decisions for their daughters' futures, but as the sisters near adulthood, they are determined to make their own choices. Then an unexpected but familiar face arrives in town, and the family's future is threatened. For Bessie and Janet, a difficult choice must be made: love or family. So that's A Family Secret by Libby Ashworth. Now, Libby Ashworth was born and raised in Lancashire, where she can trace her family back to the Middle Ages. And it was while researching her family history that she realised there were so many stories about ordinary working people that she wanted to tell. She has previously written historical novels, The De Lacy Inheritance and Loyalty Bound. A Family Secret is the third novel in the series, Milltown Lasses. So that's a bit different. That's A Family Secret by Libby Ashworth, Lancashire, 1842. Be quite interesting. Now, this will test my Australian Aboriginal pronunciations, but this is, and excuse me if I get it wrong, Billa Yarradungal Lung Dura. Billa Yarradungalung Dura, by Anita Heiss. Now, this is set in Gundagai in 1852. The powerful Murrumbidgee River surges through town, leaving death and destruction in its wake. It is a stark reminder that while the river can give life, it can just as easily take it away. Wagadani is one of the lucky ones. She survives. But is her life now better than the fate she escaped? Forced to move away from her Mayagan, she walks through each day with no trace of dance in her step, her broken heart forever calling her back home to Gundagai. When she meets Wiradjuri stockman, Yindi Amara, Wagadani's heart slowly begins to heal. But still, she dreams of a better life, away from the degradation of being owned. She longs to set out along the river of her ancestors in search of lost family and country. Can she find the courage to defy the white man's law? And if she does, will it bring hope or heartache? Set on timeless Wiradjuri country, where the life-giving waters of the rivers can make or break dreams, and based on devastating true events, Bera Yurudungalungdura, River of Dreams, is the translation, is an epic story of love, loss, and belonging. So my apologies for awful pronunciation. Aged 58, born in Sydney, Dr. Anita Marianne Heiss, the author of that book, is an Aboriginal Australian author, poet, cultural activist, and social commentator. She is an advocate for Indigenous Australian literature and literacy through her writing for adults and children and her membership of boards and committees. So I thought that would be really an interesting book to read, to look at the history of the darker side of Australian history from an Aborigine who's well versed in that subject, obviously. So that's a Billy Younger Dungalong Hurrah by Anita Heiss. Okay, next up is China. This is by Edward Rutherford. Now, Edward Rutherford, the internationally best-selling author of Sarum, London, New York, and Paris, turns his pen to the bustling modern behemoth that is China, a country full to the brim with a deep, beautiful, and sometimes violent heritage. Set from the 1800s onwards, Rutherford's beautiful novel explores the modern history of China with all the signature authenticity and interlacing personal stories that make him one of the most beloved authors of our time. Edward Rutherford is a pen name for Francis Edward Wintle, aged 73, born in Salisbury. He's best known as a writer of epic historical novels. And large novels they are too, but very, very good. Which span long periods of history, but are set in particular places. And his debut novel, Sarum, hit the pattern for his work with a 10,000-year storyline. China is a place of great interest at the moment. As you probably all realise, we're in a pandemic that originated from that country. So this particular historical novel will, I'm sure, be very well received. Very interesting book on China, and Edward Rutherford really does his research well and writes fabulous books about these places. So that's China by Edward Rutherford. Now, if you just tuned in and wondering what's going on, my name is Steve Lillyston, and you're listening to Our Library, which is a 60-minute program sponsored by the lovely folk from the libraries around Wairarapa, to let you know about some of the many new books being introduced into the libraries in the coming months. So here's some more fiction. Crusader by Ben Kane, set in 1189. Richard the Lionheart's long-awaited goal comes true as he is crowned King of England. Setting his own kingdom in order, he prepares to embark on a grueling crusade to reclaim Jerusalem. With him on every step of the journey is Ferdia, his Irish, loyal Irish follower. Together they travel from southern France to Italy, to the Kingdom of Sicily and beyond. Finally poised to sail to the Holy Land, Richard finds a bitter 2-year-long siege awaiting him. And with it, the iconic Saracen leader responsible for the loss of Jerusalem, Saladin. No one can agree who should fill the empty throne of the Kingdom of Jerusalem, and Saladin's huge army shadows Richard's every move. Conditions are brutal, the temperature's boiling, and on the dusty field of Arsuf, the Lionheart and his soldiers face their ultimate threat. Test. Now, so Ben Kane, born in Kenya in 1970, interestingly enough, he moved with his family to Ireland at the age of 7. Ben Kane studied veterinary science at the University of Dublin, but is now a very successful and popular novelist, specialising in historical fiction. He's best known for the Forgotten Legion series, which I read about 10 years ago. Thoroughly enjoyed it. Fabulous series. Spartacus and Hannibal book series. So that's Crusader by Ben Kane. Be a rollicking good book to read, I think. A Distant Shore. This is by Karen Kingsbury. She was a child caught in a riptide in the Caribbean Sea. He was a teenager from the East Coast on vacation with his family. He dove in to save her, and that single terrifying moment changed both their lives forever. 10 years later, Jack Ryder is a daring secret agent with the FBI, and Eliza Lawrence still lives on that pristine island. She is an untainted princess in a kingdom of darkness and evil, on the brink of a forced marriage with a dangerous neighbouring drug lord, a marriage arranged by her father. This time, when Jack and Eliza meet, there's a connection neither of them can explain. Both their lives are on the line, and once again the stakes are deadly high. Can they join forces in a complicated and dangerous mission, pretending to have a breathtaking love without really falling? Sometimes miracles happen not once, but twice along a distant shore. So that's A Distant Shore by Karen Kingsbury. Karen Kingsbury is an American Christian inspirational storyteller. Born in Fairfax, Virginia in 1963, she was a sports writer for the Los Angeles Times and later wrote for the Los Angeles Daily News. Her first book, Mrs. Murder, was based on a murder story that she covered in the Los Angeles Times. She's a very prolific and very successful author. Many of her books are under development as movies. Typical Hallmark movies. I don't know if you know the Hallmark series. Romantic and inspirational, as they say. So that's A Distant Shore by Karen Kingsbury. The Ends of the Earth. This is by Abby Greaves. Mary O'Connor has been keeping a vigil for her first love for the past 7 years. Every evening, without fail, Mary arrives at Ealing Broadway Station and sets herself up among the commuters. In her hands, Mary holds a sign which bears the words, "Come home, Jim." Call her mad, call her a nuisance, call her a drain on society, Mary isn't going anywhere. That is, until an unexpected call turns her world on its head. In spite of all her efforts, Mary can no longer find the strength to hold herself together. She must finally face what happened all those years ago and answer the question, where on earth is Jim? So a bit of a mystery one there. It sounds really intriguing. Abby Greaves, the author of The Ends of the Earth, studied English literature at Cambridge University before working in a literary agency for a number of years. She was inspired to write her first novel, The Silent Treatment, after reading a newspaper article about a boy in Japan who had never seen his parents speak to one another before. She currently lives in Edinburgh, and this is her second novel. So that's The Ends of the Earth by Abby Greaves. Next up is The Final Twist. This is by Jeffrey Deaver. Unique investigator Colter Shaw is searching for the answer to his father's final posthumous riddle. It will lead him to evidence that will topple the secretive espionage company Blackbridge. He believes Blackbridge to be responsible for his father's murder and his brother's disappearance. They can outmaneuver anyone, as the long trail of bodies behind them can confirm. But they haven't yet met Colter Shaw. This time the stakes are huge. The fate of a nation is in Colter's hands. He must find the solution as to why his father died, but to do that, he needs to stay alive. So a bit of a thriller there by Jeffrey Deaver. Jeffrey Deaver is another very successful and prolific mystery and crime writer. Born in Illinois in 1950, he has a Bachelor of Journalism degree from the University of Missouri and a journalism degree from Fordham University. And originally started working as a journalist. He later practiced law before embarking on a career as a novelist. So there you go, The Final Twist by Jeffrey Deaver. Very prolific, very, very popular writer. So if you like a good mystery, that sounds like one to me. Alrighty, so at this point I'll take a small music break, and when we come back I'll continue letting you know about some of the many new books coming into the library. This time we'll look at some of the non-fiction coming in to the Wairarapa libraries. So, technology being what it is, if it works okay, this is Elton John with Durban Deep from his Sleeping with the Past album.
I still love you, I still want you, I still need you. Don't hang up and say goodbye. Walking on the beach last night, hoping things would be alright, but later lying on her bed, it's you I saw instead, thinking of the one I love. You know what I'm thinking of? San Francisco days, San Francisco nights. I met a girl in Mexico and should have told her then, I know that I still think of you. We never will be through. San Francisco days, San Francisco nights. San Francisco days, San Francisco nights. I still love you, I still want you, I still need you. Don't hang up and say goodbye. Walking down on Market Street, feeling my heart skip a beat to see someone that looks like you. I guess that I'm not through dreaming of the one I love. You know what I'm dreaming of? San Francisco days, San Francisco nights. I'm headed for that Golden Gate and hoping I won't be too late to find the one that I still love. It's you I'm dreaming of. San Francisco nights. San Francisco days, San Francisco nights. San Francisco days, San Francisco nights. San Francisco, San Francisco, San Francisco nights. San Francisco, San Francisco, San Francisco.
Hi, welcome back, or if you've just tuned in, my name is Steve Lillyston and you're listening to Our Library, which is a 60-minute program sponsored by the lovely folk from the libraries around Wairarapa. To let you know about some of the many new books being introduced into the libraries and to your community's libraries in the coming months. And I'll also be talking about some of the offers, some of the services on offer at the various libraries around Wairarapa. Now, just before the music break, I covered some of the new fiction that's being introduced into the libraries in your area. And now just a small sample of the non-fiction. There are hundreds of books being introduced. I should just point that out. And I'm just covering some of the books. Hopefully, I'll give you an idea of the diverse nature of the books coming into the libraries. But I can't possibly cover all of them. There are hundreds. So just be aware of that. All the latest books are there, available for you to rent out. First up is On the Move Again. Now, this is by Neil Jeffrey Francis. Masters and born Len Francis joined New Zealand's war effort when enlisting for service in November 1940, and training became serious with the Pacific War's outbreak in December 1941. He was called into camp immediately, spending the first months of 1942 at Masterton Solway Military Camp, training for the infantry. After officer training, he was posted to anti-aircraft guns and helped prepare reinforcements in the Wellington area, and married Jean. Now, on Friday, December 16th, 2015, so that was nearly 6 years ago, Neil Francis, the author of On the Move Again, worked his last day at Wairarapa Archive, having just turned 65. What began as a childhood interest in all things military developed into a passion as adulthood approached, and it has continued to grow over the years, resulting in not only archival work and countless newspaper features, but also the authorship of several books. Mr. Francis is the son of returned World War II soldier Len Francis, who kept a war diary and spoke of his experiences as a gunner in the Italian campaign, where coincidentally my father was as well. He was in the Italian campaign and he was also a gunner, so maybe they knew each other. And the brother of Brian, who spent 25 years as a professional soldier. So there is a family history of shared interests. His work with the archive began on a part-time basis in the year 2000, interlocked with his primary job as a librarian at the Masterton Library, but morphed into a full-time job 7 years later. So that's On the Move Again by Neil Jeffrey Francis, a local author. Next up is A Coroner Speaks for the Dead to Protect the Living, and this is by Wallace Bain. Wallace Bain retired in early 2020 after 28 distinguished years as a coroner, most recently in Rotorua. During these years, Mr. Bain developed a national reputation for his sensitivity and compassion in dealing with difficult cases, such as those of Nia Glassy and Moku Rangi Toheriri, that a child is killed in New Zealand as a result of abuse every 5 weeks, he finds unacceptable, as we all do. He has also developed a reputation for being a coroner on the warpath for his forthright demands from time to time that New Zealand's laws and regulations be changed to protect ordinary citizens. His work as a coroner, says Wallace Bain, has been to speak for the dead, to take care of the living. After climbing the mountain, I can finally enjoy the view, he says. So that's Wallace Bain. He first became a coroner in the King Country and then Taupo areas from 1992. It was a part-time role. He was appointed as a full-time coroner in 2007 when the new Coroners Act came into effect, and played an instrumental role in reforming the coronial system at the time. Prior to this, Bain was mayor of Waitomo in the mid-1990s. He's also a registered pharmacist and practiced widely in the health area. He also chaired the New Zealand Rugby Federation Union's former Super 10 and Super 12 judicial committees. So that's A Coroner Speaks for the Dead to Protect the Living by Wallace Bain. That would be fascinating, I would think. Next is 50 Years a Feminist. This is by Susan Jane Kedgley, a name you might know. In 1971, Sue Kedgley and a group of other young feminists carried a coffin into Auckland's Albert Park to protest against decades of stagnant advancement for New Zealand women, since they won the right to vote in 1893. From that day, she became synonymous with the second wave feminism in this country, most notably organising a tour by Germaine Greer that ended in an arrest and court appearance. In this direct, energetic and focused autobiography, Kedgley tracks the development of feminism over the last five decades and its intersection with her life, describing how she went from debutante to stroppy activist, journalist, safe food activist and green politician. Her rich and rewarding life has included encounters with Betty Friedan, Yoko Ono, Kofi Annan, Sonia Davis and the Dalai Lama. And she has never abandoned her feminist convictions. She regrets that there is still a culture of male entitlement, sexism and double standards, and that women are still victims of violence. Even so, she argues, feminism has achieved an extraordinary amount. 50 years ago, women were sort of underclass. Now they have entered almost every sphere of national life, even if many pay a high price for their hard-won success. Now, thanks to the movement, she says, after centuries of subjugation, women are finally coming into their own. It is, she says, their time and their turn. Wow. So that's Susan Jane Kedgley, O-N-Z-M, New Zealand Order of Merit. Born in 1948, is a New Zealand politician, food campaigner and author. Before entering politics, Sue Kedgley worked for the United Nations in New York for 8 years and for a decade as a television reporter, director and producer in New Zealand. What a career she's had, and what a book that would be. 50 Years of Feminist by Susan Jane Kedgley. Love her or hate her, she's quite a character. Next is Supercharge Your Brain. This is a complete switcheroonie from anything else I've read. This is Supercharge Your Brain, How to Maintain a Healthy Brain Throughout Your Life by James Goodwin. I wish I'd have read this years ago. The Definitive Guide to Keeping Your Brain Healthy for a Long and Lucid Life by one of the world's leading scientists in the field of brain health and aging. The brain is our most vital and complex organ. It controls and coordinates our actions, thoughts and interactions with the world around us. It is the source of personality, of our sense of self, and it shapes every aspect of our human experience. Yet most of us know precious little about how our brains actually work, or what we can do to optimize their performance. Whilst cognitive decline is the biggest long-term health worry for many of us, practical knowledge of how to look after our brain is thin on the ground. Combining the latest scientific research with insightful storytelling and practical advice, Supercharge Your Brain reveals everything you need to know about how your brain functions and what you can do to keep it in peak condition. In this groundbreaking new book, leading expert Professor James Goodwin explains how simple strategies concerning exercise, diet, social life and sleep can transform your brain health paradigm and shows how you can keep your brain youthful and stay sharp across your life. Wow. A riveting read, I would think. This is James Goodwin, Professor James Goodwin. He's the director of the Brain Health Network, www.brain.health, should you need any more information on that, and a special advisor to the Global Council on Brain Health. He holds an honorary chair at the University of Exeter Medical School and is a visiting professor of physiology at the University of Loughborough. He is also a fellow of the Academy of Social Sciences. He's a former army officer and a graduate of Sandhurst. He lives in Devon and when he's not writing books, enjoys country pursuits and walking his dogs. How jolly. So that's Supercharge Your Brain, How to Maintain a Healthy Brain Throughout Your Life by Professor James Goodwin. Interesting, I thought. So that's the end of the first segment of our library, during which I gave you a very brief account of some of the many new books being introduced into the community libraries around Wairarapa. So I'll have another brief music interlude now. And when we come back, I'll talk about some of the books that I've been reading and intending to read and not quite got there. And then I'd like to talk to you about some of the wonderful programs being run at your library, the many libraries within Wairarapa. So I think we'll have a music interlude now. This is Chris Isaak singing San Francisco Days from the best of Chris Isaak.
I'm not afraid to die.
Hi, welcome back. Or if you've just tuned in, my name is Steve Lillyston and you're listening to Our Library, which is a 60-minute program sponsored by the lovely folk at the libraries from around Wairarapa. To let you know about some of the many new books being introduced into the libraries in the coming months. And I'll also be talking about some of the services on offer at the various libraries around Wairarapa. Now, in the first segment of the program, I covered some of the new fiction that's available at your community's library and just a small sample of some of the non-fiction as well. So now, at this section, I'd like to go briefly over some of the books that I've been reading, which you may find interesting, and then I'll talk about some of the services and programs available at the at your library. So here we go. So during the last month, I attempted to read or read the following six books. So the first book that I read this month was The Giver of Stars by Jojo Moyes, which I really enjoyed. Set in the 30s during the Great Depression, English woman Alice marries American businessman Bennett, moves to Kentucky, which is a real culture change for her, joins the library service to deliver books to customers by horseback across rural Kentucky. And that's based on an actual thing that happened way back during the Great Depression. It was a system initiated by Eleanor Roosevelt, the wife of the Delano Roosevelt. I love that book. I thought it was fabulous. The Giver of Stars by Jojo Moyes. Next up, I tried to read Minus Me by Mamie Medwed, and I managed about three pages. Couldn't understand a word. Nothing really stuck. No, my attention span being what it is, I put it down and didn't pick it up again. Next up was, this must be my Jojo Moyes month, because I then read Night Music by Jojo Moyes. I've read a few of Jojo Moyes' books and I really enjoyed her writing. And this is Night Music, which I quite enjoyed. It was okay. It was okay, good, not bad. Husband to violinist Isabel dies suddenly in a car crash. So she moves from her nice house in London to a decrepit mansion in a rural setting with her two young children. It's sort of all about making a new start and a bit of romance and just interesting, the move from central London to a rural setting. It was fabulous. I loved it. I thought it was really good. And then next up, just for a complete switch of pace, was Blackout by Simon Scarrow, and I just love that book. Set in Nazi Germany during World War II, concerning the investigation of a series of murders, and the main suspect is a senior member of the Nazi Party. It reminded me a little bit of Foyle's War, if you know that series, with the set during the World War II, the actions of a policeman just going through and uncovering perpetrators of crimes committed during the war, nothing to do with the war. But this is the other side of the coin. This is set in Nazi Germany, and lots of interesting things happen there. And it makes you think how they would have worked during, how policemen would have done their job under the Nazi Party. It raised some interesting ideas and thoughts. So I love that one. That's Blackout by Simon Scarrow. Next, I tried to read Crosstalk by Connie Willis. And again, I don't know what happened, but I just could not relate. This, I read about three pages and thought, no, I have no idea what this is all about. And it's a shame, because I've read a lot of Connie Willis's books before. She does a lot of writing about time travel. And some of the books are hard to keep together who's who, but I just love that whole time travel thing. I loved her work before that, but Crosstalk didn't do it for me, I'm afraid. And so I didn't do very well this month. I also tried to read After You'd Gone by Maggie O'Farrell. Now, Maggie O'Farrell wrote Hamnet, highly acclaimed book she wrote just recently, which I absolutely loved. So I thought, well, Maggie O'Farrell, can't go wrong, Irish writer. So I tried to read After You'd Gone, and I'm sorry again. Although I think I read about a third of the book, but no, it just didn't do it for me. It was very slow, very difficult. And I thought, no, I've got so many books to read. So I'm afraid I didn't get very far with that one. But I'm currently reading, you might be interested to know, it's a book that I reviewed in one of my other programs, and it's The Tally Stick by Carl Nixon, New Zealand writer. And it's set in New Zealand, and it's to do with an immigrant family, or a family comes from England to take up a position in Wellington back in the 70s, and they go for a trip around the South Island. They have an accident, go off road, and there's death and so on, and they're never seen again. And so it's the story of what happened to them, and the follow-up when the bones of one of the children are found sort of 32 years later. And so that's a fascinating read. I'm loving this book. That's The Tally Stick by Carl Nixon. I'll be able to tell you more next month about that one. So that's the books I'm reading. Now, each of the libraries in Wairarapa have a presence on Facebook. So check out the wide variety of programs that they're having on offer. Programs for the young and old. At the library of your community. There's always something interesting there. I'll have a look at some of the programs at the Masterson Library. They have a brochure called Check It Out, which goes through some of their programs. Oh, by the way, I'd just like to mention the librarians are there for your convenience. They're there to help you with any questions you may have. Don't be afraid to ask. I think the image of librarians, the old image of librarians as being fusty old creatures stuck in the corners that you're not allowed to talk to, who tell you to be quiet all the time, that's gone. That's old school. They're very, very approachable. They're lovely people. So please don't be afraid to ask them anything you like. They're there just to help you. So the programs. So the programs available at the Marston Library in June. There's so many programs. I'm not going to read them all. I'll go through some of them. Baby Bounce. There's for mums and dads with little babies. These are the under twos. You can take your under two along, listen to stories in English and some in Te Reo at the library every Tuesday during school term. I was in the library the other day, and I walked in as they were holding one of these sessions for the young children, and it was just delightful to watch, and it's so well done. So if you've got a young under two, or the preschool age, a little bit older, it's called Story Go Round. Explore the world of books and enjoy the magic of stories and activities in their preschool story time. Feel free to bring a morning snack. Tea and coffee provided, can't be bad. And that's every Wednesday during school term. There are just so many programs. There's the Lego Play. If you're interested in Lego, if that's your thing, pop in and play Lego. So that's every Thursday. And there are adult programs. The Justice of the Peace is available. If you've got anything you need to have signed. There are sustainability workshops, can you believe? Join us every month for a workshop on sustainability. Sit, Knit and Yarn is another fabulous program that they have for you to go along, if that's your thing. If you're a crafty sort of person, enjoy craft work, Sit, Knit and Yarn might be for you. Scrabble, there's the Marston Scrabble Club meets at the library. Women's Cross Stitch. There's another one called The Gathering. Now, this is just join neighbours, family and friends in a friendly and safe place where you can talk, share and make the space your own. It's just a venue for you to pop along and just have a chat. Look at some books, play some jigsaws. It's all there. And digital programs. There's lots of digital advice. There's if you've got any problems with your digital device, you can pop along there and get help. Digital seniors, Marston Hub meets there. If you need any help with your CV, putting together a CV, they'll be able to help you. So go along to the library, check it out. It's a little brochure, it's a two-page brochure, one for the description of the programs and then a calendar showing you the dates that they're on. Fabulous. I mean, there's just so much going on at the library. It's more than just books. CDs, posters, magazines, lots of magazines. But there are those programs, and it's a wonderful facility. And it's free, by the way. It's free to join the library. The activities are typically free, and those aren't are just by COHA. It's a fabulous community service, so a community facility. Coming up on Friday the 2nd of July at 4:30 to 6:30 is Matariki Abundance in the New Year. This is a night of free family fun featuring the story of Matariki, Matariki items from the archive, flax weaving, kiritohi for the kids, shared kai, kapa haka, musical performance by Hemi Walker, tech demo and giveaway arts and crafts. Matariki Abundance in the New Year 2021, Friday the 2nd of July at 4:30 for 2 hours. So that's Marston. That's what's going on at the Marston Library. Now, on the Wairarapa Library service, that's Greytown, Carterton, Featherston, Martinborough. I've got a write-up of some of the things going on here. So they're going live with offering Skinny Jump modems. Skinny Jump is a flexible prepaid broadband. Only $5 for 30 gigabytes of data, no contract or credit checks, and the modem comes free of charge. Just top up as you go. Skinny Jump is for those who don't have a broadband connection at home because cost is a barrier. It supports those most at risk of digital exclusion. So if you feel you're excluded digitally, this could be for you. Now, all Wairarapa Library Service libraries, these are in the South Wairarapa area, will have a regular Justice of the Peace drop-in sessions every month from July. Check out individual branch Facebook pages. All the libraries in Wairarapa, in fact, have a Facebook presence. So there's details on the Facebook pages, or you can just go in and ask at the library. In Martinborough, the last Thursday of the month from 11 to 1, the Justice of the Peace is there. Featherston, last Saturday of the month, 11 to 1. Greytown, last Thursday each month, 11 to 1. Carterton, every Friday, 12 to 2. A Justice of the Peace is available for you. And if you're uncertain, if you missed all that, just contact your library and find out the date, the times. There's also the Whā Kōrero, a weekly preschool story time on Tuesdays and Thursday mornings. That's free. Come along, check the Facebook page for when it's next at your library. A podcasting workshop. Here's a good one. How to make a podcast. Being planned for July, keep an eye on the newspapers and newsletters or the library Facebook pages for more information. And as libraries head into the end of the financial year, we're receiving lots of new collections from items from our vendors. In the case of the Wairarapa Library System, they've recently increased the stock in some areas which are popular and or needed refreshed. They've recently bought significant new stock in addition to the regular buying of adult graphic novels, large print, talking books, biographies and first readers coming into the collections. Martinborough, Featherston and Greytown libraries have all recently had a few adjustments made to their layouts. New areas for reading or studying have been created. Collections have been moved around so that they are highlighted and flow more easily. And there is additional seating. If you haven't been into a library recently, come and have a look. There's something for everybody at the library. There's so much there. And as I said before, the librarians are very approachable. If there's anything you need, any questions you have, don't be afraid. Go along. They're not ogres or anything. They're lovely people. So you can pop along to your library and ask them anything you need. So that's the hopefully that gives you an idea of what's available. And the good news is it's all free. Your local library doesn't cost anything to join. Most of the programs are free. Occasionally some of the DVDs have a $2 charge on them, as I found out. Some of the DVDs that I've rented have got a $2 charge, which isn't bad. You've got them for a week. You can't go wrong, really. And the programs are just fabulous. So pop along to your library, see what's available. And, of course, all the books that are coming in each month, incredible books. And what I've found, too, any books that if you search online, I search a lot online, check in for any books that you're interested in. If they're not in the library, if nobody has them, you can request that they buy it. They purchase it for you, and they do. They've done that a number of times on books that I've been interested in that aren't in the library. They will buy them in for you, and you will be alerted when the book comes in, and you'll be first there to receive it when it comes in. Fabulous, fabulous service that they have. So I think that about wraps it up, I think, for another month. So I'm Steve Lillyston. That was Our Library, which is a 60-minute program sponsored by the lovely folk from the libraries around Wairarapa, to let you know about some of the many new books being introduced and some of the services that the libraries have to offer. So thank you for tuning in. I hope you enjoyed the show. Please tune in again to our next broadcast of Our Library, which will be on Friday, July 16th at 3:30 on Arrow 92.7 FM, your community radio access channel, and Wairarapa TV on Freeview Channel 41. Until then, happy reading. Bye-bye.